I would like to welcome everyone the name of the organization of the Springs 2021 event. It's our pleasure to have Tom Hartman from Cornell here to give a series of three lectures on loopholes and the information paradox. And just before he starts, I just remind you that we're going to have this 1 hour lecture, and then we'll have a 15 minute pause before the discussion sessions later on. During the discussion sessions, we probably may want to ask questions and things that we cannot cover during the first 1 hour because, well, frankly, there are lots of people, and we are not sure we'll be able to provide for questions for everyone. So, again, Tom, let me thank you for accepting the invitation and move on, and you may start.
Great, thanks a lot. It's fun to be here. So, let's see. Before I get into it, I want to start with a couple of things. One of the great things about doing these schools. Actually, can you see me when I'm talking? Because it doesn't.
Yeah. We can see you.
Okay. So I need to adjust it because. A great thing about these schools is getting to meet the participants and the students, and it's going to be harder over Zoom, but I'm happy to interact with people over the Slack channel and in the discussion session, and I really encourage people to take up on that, and I hope we can have some interesting discussions. During the lecture, I would say, since we have so many people, let's keep the questions during the lecture to sort of clarification type things that I can answer hopefully relatively quick. And for more discussion type things, we'll do that in the discussion. But if you're not sure, just jump right in. Are we doing questions in the chat, or what's the procedure that you've been using here?
Well, some people are asking in the chat, but we ask them to write in the questions down if they think it's there too long, and then wait until the discussion session. But it's rather
okay.
Up to you.
Okay, great. So
if you want, I can just read the chat, and then, I mean.
Okay, perfect. So,
let me also intervene. We also ask participants to raise their hand, use this tool of Zoom too, before they ask the question.
Sounds good. Okay, perfect. So, so feel free to ask during. I'm not going to monitor the chat because it's too confusing to do that while speaking, but somebody else is looking at it and can jump in and ask the questions. Good. Okay. So let me get started. So what I want to do in these lectures is to describe recent developments on the information paradox, and in particular the role of entanglement islands and wormholes in the calculation of the entropy of Hawking radiation. We wrote a review on this topic last year, which is here. So the review is really it's a conceptual review. It doesn't really go much into the calculations and equations, but just describes the ideas. And I encourage students to read that also, because what I really want to do in these lectures is to give a more hands-on and more technical point of view on some of these developments. What we're going to do in the lectures is to actually work through a complete example. As far as we can get, we're going to work through a complete example of the calculation of the entropy of Hawking radiation. Whereas in this review, you can read a more general description of the kind of ideas involved and get more out of it that way. The other thing I would encourage you to do, if you're new to this topic, is to watch this talk. This is where you can find lots of talks on this topic online, colloquium level talks. This is just one that I gave a week or two ago. It's about a 30-minute talk. On this topic, it just lays out the basic idea at a sort of high level. And so I can stick that in the chat here so that people have this point. sense of where we're headed. Okay. Now, I want to get right into this example, but let me give a quick explanation of the pain curve for people that are new to this area, and I'll tell you where we're headed with these lectures. So the page curve is a plot of the entropy of Hawking radiation. Okay, so according to Hawking's calculation, the Hawking radiation is thermal. Okay, so as the black hole evaporates, the entropy of the radiation goes up, 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 until eventually the black hole is gone. The black hole is done evaporating, and at that point, it just saturates and is constant for all time. So this is Hawking's calculation of the entropy of the radiation. My iPad just replaced this with a straight line. It actually is a straight line in two-dimensional gravity, but more generally, it's some curve for the entropy. Good. Now we can compare that to the area of the black hole. Okay, so now I'm going to plot area over 4, which is the entropy of the black hole. And this area over 4 is decreasing because the black hole is evaporating away, and that'll decrease to 0, and it's now just the black hole is gone, so the area is 0. And we have an information paradox. As soon as these two lines cross, and we'll get into that a little bit more in the lectures, but the basic idea is that the entropy of the radiation is there because the radiation is entangled with the field inside the black hole. It's entangled with the black hole itself. And the black hole only has the area over 4 degrees of freedom. So it's impossible to create more than that amount of, more than entropy area over 4 through entangling with that black hole. Okay, so as we follow the Hawking curve up, this is fine. The fact that the entropy is increasing, that's no problem. But as soon as we get to this point here, which is called the page time, we start to see a paradox, because as soon as this curve is bigger than the area of the black hole, that contradicts basic principles of entropy and quantum information. Okay, so what Page said is that if black hole evaporation is unitary, then the true curve should look something like this. That is, the true curve should go up following Hawking's calculation until the page time, and then suddenly turn over and go back to 0. At the end of the process, this entropy of the radiation should be 0 because it should be a pure state. Now, it's important to point out, and we'll get into this in detail, but it's important to point out here that we're not talking about thermodynamic entropy. We're talking about von Neumann entropy, and the von Neumann entropy as a rho minus trace rho log rho is constant under unitary evolution and vanishes in a pure state. Okay, so in these lectures, what we're going to do is we're going to do most of the calculations in this plot. Okay, so we're going to calculate the Hawking. We're going to calculate the Hawking curve, calculate the entropy of the Hawking radiation by a classic method. And then in the second half, we're going to talk about including wormholes in the gravitational path integral and show that gives this part of the curve through the gravitational path integral. So that's the plan for these lectures. Basically, it's going to take a lecture. It's going to take roughly a lecture to set things up in the example that I want to set up. roughly a lecture to calculate this curve and then a lecture to calculate this curve. And putting it all together, we'll have a complete example of the paradox and of the wormhole contributions. Okay, good. So without further ado, let me jump in to the example that I want to discuss. Okay, so the example we'll be talking about is the eternal black hole in two-dimensional dilaton gravity in flat space-time. So I first need to introduce this theory. As by way of motivation, let me start with a four-dimensional metric with spherical symmetry. So the most general thing you can write is a 2D metric that I'll call G mu mu plus a 2-sphere with a space-time dependent free factor, which depends on the two dimensions. So that factor there is the dilaton. And this is basically describes an S wave of general relativity in four dimensions. And you can now take this en masse for the metric, plug it back into the action of general relativity, and find the effective action in two dimensions. And that looks something like this. So now this is, in terms of the 2D metric, there's the overall dilaton, e to the minus 2 phi. And then we have curvature term, a kinetic term for the dilaton, a cosmological constant, and the Lagrangian of whatever matter fields happen to be present in your theory. Okay, so this is general relativity in the S wave. A point I want to make here is that the area of the 2-sphere is 4 pi e to the minus 2 pi. So you should think of the dilaton phi, or really e to the minus 2 pi, as the transverse area of the higher dimensional theory. Now, when we go to more general dilaton gravity, there isn't necessarily an interpretation like that, but it's often a good way to think about it. So, in particular, we'll use that in order to think about the black hole singularity, because singularities are a little tricky in two-dimensional gravity, and we'll use it to think about the horizon. So the apparent horizon of a black hole is where outgoing null rays will actually have contraction, will have negative expansion. So the apparent horizon in terms of the dilaton is the surface where the outgoing derivative of phi vanishes. This will be positive outside the apparent horizon, negative inside the apparent horizon. And we'll use that to diagnose where the black hole is. Okay, so now we could proceed with that model, but that's not what we're going to do, because basically these equations that the action that I just had is still pretty complicated, although it's two-dimensional, it's still pretty complicated, and we can't write down closed solutions analytically. You can study this theory numerically. You can even include the problem of x numerically, and you just have to solve some differential equations on a computer. But it's a lot more convenient to be able to do that analytically. So what we're going to do is change the Lagrangian a little bit, as people did in some classic papers in the 80s and 90s, and look at a very similar theory. So a very similar but easier model is what's called the RSP model. So the action of the RSP model is 1/2 pi integral root minus g. The gravitational term is e to the minus 2 pi r plus 4 grad phi squared plus 4 minus n over 24 phi r. And then we have the matter term. So n here is the number of fields, or the central charge, of the matter sector. So we're going to be assuming that the matter sector is a conformal field theory. It's, or it could just be a free theory. Okay, so you can take this to be n free bosons, or you can take it to be n free Dirac fermions. If you want to be concrete about this, then some of the calculations of entanglement entropy are easiest in the Dirac fermion. So we can take this to be n free Dirac fermions, but for most of what I'll say, maybe all of what I'll say, this is independent of the matter sector as long as it's conformal. So this model is called the CGHS or RST model. More recently, there's essentially the same model that's sometimes called the flat JT, the flat JT theory. So a lot of the recent work has been in Dirac-Teitelbaum gravity, which has a negative cosmological constant. This theory, which goes back to these papers of CGHS and RST, is equivalent to JT gravity under a change of variables and changing the cosmological constant. So it's in asymptotically flat. Okay, there was a hand there was a hand. Somebody want to ask a question?
Hi. I was confused about these RST and CGHS. So since these are the same, so now it is clear to me. But I was just asking about this cosmological constant term. As in the previous model, you conveniently choose it to be 2 over L square. In the unit of L is equal to 1, it's kind of 2. But in this model, it is not clear which is the, what is the value of the cosmological constant. So that was my question.
Okay, yeah, let me make a couple comments. The first is that this, if you're talking about this constant here, there's a dimensionful number here, which I've set to 1. We could set this to any number. I've just set it to 1 because this makes it easy to look at the old papers, and that's what's often done there. The question about CGHS versus RST is the following. So, let me scroll back and show you what's different about this model. There's a couple things. The kinetic term of the dilaton has a different coefficient, and the CC term. So in the S wave of four-dimensional gravity, this e to the 2 phi cancels this e to the minus 2 phi, whereas in the CGHS or RST model, there's no further exponential here. Okay, so the potential for the dilaton is different in the two series. This term here is what distinguishes the CGHS model from the RST model. Okay, so in the work of CGHS, they did not have this term, but the advantage of including it is that you can now solve the theory exactly analytically, including loops. Okay, so if you don't include this term, then the theory is not, the equations are not integrable once you include quantum effects. But if you do include this term, it just simplifies the equations a bit, and now they're integrable even with loop corrections. So
mm-hmm. It looks similar to this Lewis kind of gravity in 2D, right? Like you replace N by Q, and Q is a little parameter like B plus B 1 over B kind of thing. So this is the central charge also. So am I correct in this regard? Like this is a kind of similar form to 2D.
It's similar. Yeah, it's similar. Yeah.
So could you please mention what is R, S, and T? Is this name? Sorry, I don't know this model. I know this is CGHL, but I don't know.
Let's see. Who's R? I think R, I think, is Russo. Is that right? Is somebody?
I find it.
Sorry. And Prolaskis.
Thanks a lot.
There's another question by Igor. Igor, you may, yeah, just.
Hi, can you hear me? Hello?
Yes,
you can hear me. Okay, fine. Can you give me a motivation for the second model, action, deflect JT, as you have done for the S wave? You began with a metric, and then you plug into Einstein and write an effective action functional. Can you do the same?
If you're asking for a higher dimensional model that reduces to this, I don't know of one. The motivation is really that we think the physics of this model is essentially the same, qualitatively the same as the physics of the S wave in four dimensions, but the equations are just easier to work with. Really, anything that I say you can do in the S wave theory as well, but you're going to have to solve these equations numerically.
Oh, I see. Thank you.
Okay. Let's see. So as I mentioned, the advantage here is that this is exactly solvable to leading order in large n. Okay. So what we're going to be doing is we're going to be working at large n, so we have a large number of fields, and then we can work to leading order in large n, but to all orders in h bar. Okay. So that's the regime that we're going to be in for all these lectures, and that's the regime in which the RST model is exactly solvable analytically. In particular, you can write down an analytic solution for evaporating for black holes in this theory that's formed by gravitational collapse through a shell of collapsing matter, then evaporate through Hawking radiation until they evaporate completely. Okay, so in this theory, you can just write down in closed form, quite simply, the metric for that process. That's not something you can do in an S wave in four dimensions, and certainly not something that we can do in higher dimensions. Okay, so I want to write down the equations of motion. First, we're going to gauge fix by setting the metric in conformal gauge, e to the minus 2 rho, dx plus dx minus. And you can also fix the dilaton phi to be equal to the conformal factor up to a constant, which is the half log n over 12. And for convenience, let me also define we're going to just do a field redefinition for the dilaton and talk about the dilaton omega, which is e to the minus 2 rho plus rho over 2 minus a half log n over 24. So this is just the change of variables that's going to be convenient to write the equations of motion. Then the equations to all loop leaving n are very simple. The first equation is b plus b minus omega is equal to minus 1. And the other equations are d plus minus squared omega is minus 12 pi over n. T plus minus flat, where I'm about to define what that is. So the stress tensor in this theory, in the physical metric, e to the 2 rho dx plus dx minus, is t plus 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 minus the anomaly, n over 12 pi d plus rho squared minus d plus squared rho. Okay, so this calling this thing t flat is just a definition, but it has the following interpretation. The idea is that you can pick this function, t plus plus flat, you should think about it as your choice of state for the CFT, because we have gravity coupled to a CFT here. So this is your choice of state for the CFT. You could take, for example, a delta function on a null surface, which would correspond to a collapsing shell of matter. And then this is the Weyl anomaly. It comes from taking this state in flat space and then doing a Weyl transformation to put it into this curved space. Okay, so that just accounts for the conformal factor in the metric. The reason that this theory is exactly solvable to all orders in h bar is that by extracting the anomaly this way, we put all of the effect of the metric into this anomaly term, and now the quantum fields are basically just free fields in flat space, and we just have this anomaly term that enters the gravitational equations of motion, which are these. Okay, so that's the theory, and as I said, you can solve these equations completely in closed form. What I mean by that is that given any choice of this matter stress tensor in flat corresponding to some state of a free field in flat space, given any function here, you can integrate these equations of motion and write a simple equation for omega, the dilaton. I'm not going to write the general solution because we're not going to need it. The solution that we're going to be working with is the eternal black hole. So the eternal black hole solution in this theory is simply the one with T flat equal to zero, and omega, the dilaton, equal to minus x plus x minus plus m. So we can easily check that this solves the equation of motion. The first equation here is satisfied from the x plus x minus term, and the second equation says zero on the right hand side. So we have here a solution of this theory. In order to see, sorry, there's a question to Shala.
What is the boundary condition that we have chosen for the dilaton?
I'll let you ask some time in just a second.
Okay, thanks.
But it's, the boundary condition is such that we're in asymptotically flat space. So I need to explain to you why this is a eternal black hole. Okay, so in order to do that, we should look at the metric. Okay, remember the metric was e to the minus 2 rho dx plus dx minus. And rho here, we've traded rho for big omega. Okay, so in order to get back to the metric, we have to convert this solution for omega to a solution for rho. We had the equation relating them up a page, but let me write the inverse equation. So the inverse equation is that rho equals 2 omega plus log 2 plus a half the product log function of minus e to the minus 4 omega. So the product log function is just the solution of, it's just by definition the solution of this equation. Okay, so this has a solution. The reason I write the formula, we're not gonna use it, but the reason I'm writing the formula is if, for example, you want to plug this in mathematics or something, it's product log is built in, so you can plot everything in Mathematica and do everything very explicitly to invert this. That's why we introduced the function omega. It's because in terms of omega, we don't have to deal with these terrible product log in all our expressions. Okay, so if you take our solution here for the dilaton and convert that into the conformal factor, rho, then here's what you find. You find that asymptotically, the metric is ds squared is approximately dx plus dx minus over x plus x minus. I'm going to call this one an exercise. Okay, so this is something you can do at home when you're working through your notes. If I write exercise next to something, it means that I've really given you everything you could possibly need in order to do the problem. So I recommend you work through it, just to avoid spending our time on that. If we take that and we expand near the horizon, well, first of all, we should ask, where is the horizon? The horizon is at the apparent horizon is where the dilaton is stationary in both directions. It's in both directions because this is an eternal black hole, And in an internal black hole, your time horizon is also the event horizon. So we set these to zero, and that gives us a horizon as an x plus x minus equal to zero. And if we take our solution for the dilaton, plug into this inversion product log, then you find that the metric near the horizon is approximately flat in the x coordinate, dx plus dx minus. Let's make that one an exercise too. Okay, we're also going to, you should think of these x plus, x minus coordinates as like crustal coordinates. I'll draw the Penrose diagram in a second, and you'll see why. But we also want to introduce Schwarzschild. Coordinates, which in this case are really just regular coordinates for the x plane. So the usual transformation from the plane to regular coordinates is nice in terms of no coordinates, which is x plus minus is plus minus e to the plus minus sigma plus minus. And now I can draw a black hole. Okay, so let's see. We're in two dimensions, so the Penrose diagram from Minkowski space has two infinities, a left infinity and a right infinity, unlike in higher dimensions. And those just become the two sides of this black hole. So the coordinates that I'm using here are the x minus and x plus coordinates. And this theory, so this metric is conformally flat. So what makes it a black hole? Okay, and this is always a little tricky in dilaton gravity. But really the way to think about, I think the clearest way to think about black holes in dilaton gravity is to go back to the intuition from higher dimensions. Okay, so the dilaton, remember, came from the area of the transverse sphere in higher dimensions. So the singularity is when that area goes to zero. We're not doing S-wave here. We're looking at a different theory. But if you treat that if you treat our dilaton as being a transverse area, then the singularity is at some fixed value of omega. Okay, so in other words, we impose on this theory that omega cannot go below some critical value. In the old literature, the critical value was 1/4 based on treating this as the area of a two-sphere. But you can shift that value, you can shift the dilaton by a constant, so the actual value is not so important. What's important is that there is a critical value of omega, and so we view, when omega hits the critical value, we view that as the singularity. And anything with omega less than 1/4, we treat as unphysical. So in this picture, omega equals 1/4 is here, And so this part of the space-time doesn't actually exist, and similarly down here.
We got a question from...
Yes, go ahead.
Shirokuma?
Hi, did you say that Horizon is at the denser omega equals 0 and then minus omega equals 0?
Yes, the horizon is, yes.
But I said our equation motion said delta z minus equal to minus 1. So the equation motion is not satisfied on the other thing?
Yeah, good point. Sorry. I must have messed that up. Yeah, I think this should have been, yeah, thank you. So these things here, they should have been the old dilaton, not the new dilaton. I hope that that's right now. I'll have to go back and check it later. I think those should have been the old dilaton, because that was the one we were using when we talked about the apparent horizon before. But you're right. Well, we're in a gauge where those are equal up to a constant. So
okay, good. And second, could you again repeat the singularity for the index value we need to understand on focus?
Well, in terms of the, yeah, let's see, I don't have to change the variables to the old dilaton, but if you think about the, let me do this in the, since I don't have the change variables in order to do it for this theory, let's go back to the S-wave theory, where this is easy. So back in the S-wave theory, the area of the two-sphere is e to the minus 2 phi. Okay, so phi equals infinity is a singularity. And if you do something similar for the RST model and you track through all those changes of variables that we did, then you'll find that the singularity is at omega equals 1/4. So there is no real physical value of phi that goes below omega equals 1/4.
Okay, thank you.
Another question from Julie Pereira.
Yeah, I just have a doubt regarding the rho plus phi and the rho minus phi. That seems like an extremal surface. Is that correct? I mean, why is that the near horizon region? Because, yeah, there.
Sorry, this is the horizon, and I'm saying that near the horizon, the metric looks like that.
I see. Okay.
Okay, so this issue of the singularity is subtle. In a recent literature on dilaton gravity, like most of the papers on JT gravity, people usually declare the singularity to be at omega equals minus infinity. In variables that are very similar to the in the same variables that I'm using here, so this big omega is like the dilaton of JT gravity that people usually talk about, and there they think of the singularity. They often think of the singularity as being at minus infinity. This is good if you're trying to avoid the singularity and sort of push it off to the edge of the diagram where you don't have to worry about it. But really, we should always keep in mind the dilaton gravity that there is some value where the dilaton is cut off. And if we really want to have a uni-complete theory, we probably need to deal with that singularity somehow. Okay, so that's usually avoided in the discussions of JT gravity, but it was really the issue that it was what people struggled with back in the 90s when they were looking at these models, and it was never really resolved, and still hasn't been resolved in trying to use and complete these theories that people talk about recently. For all purposes, fortunately, we're really just going to be doing effective field theory, and it's not a problem that we don't know how to UV complete this low energy effective theory. Okay. One other thing I should put on this diagram is the Schwarzschild coordinates. So the Schwarzschild coordinates, or Rayleigh coordinates, sigma plus, sigma minus, just cover the outside patch, like the ordinary Schwarzschild coordinates. So really what we're talking about here is really just two-dimensional Minkowski space. Of course, it's conformally flat. It's really just two-dimensional Minkowski space. And it's the dilaton that makes it a black hole. Okay, so we're doing two-dimensional Minkowski space. The Rindler space becomes the outside of the horizon. But it's the fact that the dilaton has a cutoff that makes us think about this as a black hole in this theory. To see that, to see some more features of black holes here, let's look at the state of the quantum fields in this solution. We started out in the X vacuum. Okay, we remember that the solution was T plus plus flat is, and minus minus flat is equal to zero. That was in the X coordinate. That means that in the sigma coordinate, the stress tensor is given entirely by the anomaly, which is the Schwarzian derivative, minus n over 24 pi times the Schwarzian derivative, x plus minus, sigma plus minus. And you can easily plug in the exponential into this Schwarzian derivative, and you'll find n over 48 pi. So the conclusion is that in the sigma coordinates, there's a constant flux going both in and out of the black hole. I may have forgot to mention that the asymptotic metric, I think I wrote it in x coordinates, but in sigma coordinates, the metric is just asymptotically Minkowski, minus d sigma plus d sigma minus. So just like the ordinary Schwarzschild coordinates, it's the sigma coordinates that you should think of as being the nice ordinary asymptotically flat coordinates. And what the calculation that I just did with the Schwarzian derivative showed that an inertial observer near infinity will observe a constant ingoing flux. So there's an ingoing flux here and a constant outgoing flux here, which is exactly what you expect for a black hole in equilibrium with some radiation. So what this solution describes is called the Hartle-Hawking state. And it's a black hole in equilibrium with radiation. The pictures that I just drew were Lorentzian. I also want to draw the Euclidean pictures for this black hole, because we're going to be using Euclidean methods to calculate the entropy. So far from the black hole, we had dx plus dx minus over x plus x minus, which in Euclidean signature just becomes dz dz bar over mod z squared, or mod d log z squared, which is the metric on a cylinder, a flat cylinder. Because the log takes the cylinder to the plane. So in terms of the log z coordinate, this metric is flat. And therefore, in terms of the z coordinate, since it's a flat cylinder, if we look near the horizon, then we said that the metric there was just dz dz bar. So near the horizon, it's just flat. And now we can draw a picture of this Euclidean geometry. Well, I should tell you that if you can also just plot the function for the whole radial direction, and you'll find that it just smoothly interpolates between a cylinder and flat space. So what's the geometry that interpolates between cylinder and flat space? Well, it starts out over here as a cylinder. So this is let me call it x, which is sigma plus minus sigma minus. So it starts out as a cylinder. So the cylinder has an identification under z goes to z e to the 2 pi I. In terms of log z, of course, that's the usual thermal periodicity of a finite temperature state. But as we go in towards the black hole, this has to smoothly match on to flat space. So the geometry looks something like this in Euclidean. The tip here is the Euclidean horizon. And if you, if you zoom in on some patch near the Euclidean horizon, that's this flat space and polar coordinates, so that's exactly what you expect in these. That's exactly what you expect, this dz dz bar. So this is called the cigar geometry. And it's generally the Euclidean geometry of a black hole, of an eternal black hole. It's also helpful to think about how this relates to the Lorentzian picture. So let me draw quickly again this Lorentzian diagram. So if we pick a slice at time zero on the Lorentzian diagram, well, t equals zero is both a real number and an imaginary number. So that's where these diagrams meet. And that slice that I just drew on the Lorentzian picture is this slice on the cigar. The thing on the front of the cigar is the part of the in the right space time. The thing on the back of the cigar is in the left space time. The other way I like to think about this is to draw the Euclidean picture as coming out of the board, out of the page. Okay, so Lorentzian goes on the page and Euclidean goes out of the page. And then this part that's coming out, that's the z plane, which is, remember, asymptotically dz squared over z squared. So we can think of that. So basically, I've done the exponential math on that cylinder and drawn it as coming out of the board. So the other special point that I should point out here is the bifurcation point of the horizon and Lorentzian signature, which is the tip of the Euclidean cigar. Okay, since I only have 2 minutes left, let me pause at this point and see if you have questions about these diagrams, because we're going to be using these over and over again. Okay, then I'll just go ahead and set up what we're going to do next in my last 2 minutes. Well, what we're really interested in is the evaporating black hole. We're going to use the eternal black hole as a toy model, but what we're really interested in is the evaporating black hole. There are evaporating black holes in this theory, as I described. The Penrose diagram looks like this. They have an ingoing shell of matter, what that means in equations is just that P sigma plus is a delta function. It's some energy times delta of sigma plus minus sigma naught plus. Okay, so this is a solution that can be found explicitly in this theory. It's a black hole that forms by collapse and then evaporates completely. And what we're interested in calculating is the entropy of the radiation. The way we're going to do that is to define a region R out here far away from the black hole, R for radiation. We define rho sub R to be the density matrix of region R. And then our goal is to calculate the von Neumann entropy, S of rho sub R, is equal to minus trace rho sub R log rho sub R. Okay, and I'll stop there for today. So bring your questions to the discussion, and we'll continue with this in the next lecture.
Okay, great. Thank you, Tom, for the lecture. I guess everybody can unmute and let's clap. Tom, or give a raised hand or give a clap or whatever if you like. Okay. Does anybody have any short questions? I guess this is your time. Okay. So, right, we can always wait until the discussion session. Tom will be back at just check the time. That will be 4 p.m. local time in 1 hour. And then we will